Good evening to all. I am Dr. Kumaraguru, working as a conservation scientist on behalf of BCF, a NGO based at Tamil Nadu in India, with the vision is visualizing society for promoting and assisting healthy coexistence of human and wildlife and ultimately ensuring conservation of biodiversity. So strategic implementation of this session draws us to handle research and reaching stakeholders in synchronized manner. Our research includes from ants to elephants, and exploring effective management practices in the perspective of biodiversity conservation. With our wide research expertise team, we are able to walk from Nagapattinam to Valley of Flower Himalayas, stretching across different landscapes and different people and very dependency on the ecosystem. In nutshell, we connect nature with people, people with nature. So let's get connected today, also in the virtual platform to existence, and experience nature in enhanced dimension. Thank you all. Thank you for joining today BCF International Webinar.
Good evening to all. Celebrating 25th, that is Silver Jubilee International Webinar, we appreciate all our national and international participants in their participation and extending the support which helps us to conduct all virtually. On behalf of BCF India, I am privileged in introducing our today's speaker, Dr. S.F. Wesley Sundarraj, Director and Principal Scientist, Eco Consultant, Green Future Foundation, India. He started his wildlife research after completion of MSc in Wildlife Biology and completed his PhD in Wildlife Science. He is a professional with over 34 years of experience in the field of wildlife and habitat ecology, biodiversity assessment and conservation plan, integrated biodiversity management plan, restoration of mining sites, natural resource management and action plans, and regional environmental status and management plan. He also gained parallel experience of 25 years in the field of environmental impact assessment and environmental management plan, which includes 78 projects such as in oil and gas pipelines, roads, highways, mining and cement plants, isolated storage terminals, salt works, etc. in different states of the country. He has done management and involvement in overall of 130 research and consultancy projects, which includes 15 on wildlife ecology and biodiversity, 78 on EIA and EMP, 9 on regional environmental status and management plan, 5 on natural resources development and management, 6 on wildlife conservation and management plan, 3 on birds and bat collision monitoring, and 14 on biodiversity management plan in mining sector. All his projects were funded by international agencies such as World Bank, UNDP and UNEP. He has also research experience in different types of forest habitats covering Western Ghats, Eastern Ghats, foothills of Himalaya, grassland and tropical thorn forests of semi-arid regions and coastal habitats of Gujarat state. He is currently the Director and Principal Scientist, Eco Consultant, Green Future Foundation, India since 2012. From 1995 to 2011, he was Senior Principal Scientist and Head of Terrestrial Ecology Division in Gujarat Institute of Desert Ecology. From 1992 to 1995, he was Research Personnel in Wildlife Institute of India on EIA studies on linear development projects in oil and gas pipelines. From 1988 to 1992, he worked as Senior Research Fellow in Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun, on the project Elephant Movement in the Foothills, that is corridor between Corbett and Rajaji National Parks of Himalaya in Uttar Pradesh. From 1986 to 1988, he was Junior Research Fellow in Wildlife Institute of India, Dehradun, on the project Ecology and Conservation of Endangered Nilgiri Langur, Kalakad Mundanthurai Tiger Reserve, Tamil Nadu. From 1985 to 1986, he worked as research assistant in BNHS Bombay under Dr. Salim Ali Conservation Fund research project, feeding and ranging behavior of endangered Nilgiri Langur, Mundanthurai Sanctuary, Tamil Nadu. His publications include 3 chapters and book, 19 journals and newsletters, and 14 short notes. He is serving as a member in various professional bodies. To highlight few of them, they are: from 1993 to 2000, he was member of IUCN Species Survival Commission in Primate Specialist Group. He is also a member of International Sea Turtle Society since 2002, IUCN Species Survival Commission in Sea Turtle Specialist Group since 2006, and executive member of Turtle Action Group India since 2008. He was also a member of Honorable Supreme Court appointed EIA committee member for environmental status assessment of Bellary Iron Ores Mine, Karnataka, and member and advisor for Ecological Monitoring Cells, ESSAR Energy Gujarat Private Limited. He is an out-of-the-box thinker contributing towards achieving stiff targets and successfully led various projects. He is an effective communicator combined with flexible attitude and ability to interact effectively in the team. During this COVID-19, BCF extended the platform in connecting the eminent professionals, stakeholders, students and public on this international webinar. We are delighted to connect our eminent and well-experienced speaker, Dr. S.F. Wesley Sundar Raj, Director and Principal Scientist, Eco-Consultant, Green Future Foundation India, on this virtual forum and waiting to listen on biodiversity attributes and conservation aspects of arid region. Over to you, sir.
Good evening to everybody. I would like to talk on the biodiversity attributes of dry land of Kutch district, which is mainly focusing on the arid biodiversity value of arid ecosystem. Okay, before I go get into the issue of arid areas of Kutch, I would like to discuss about the biodiversity. When we talk about the biodiversity, people think that they have the different views on what is biodiversity. Some people, they immediately think on the wild place or wilderness area, forest, or some people, they think on the abundance of species. Biodiversity means abundance of species. The common man, mostly when they think on the biodiversity, they immediately imagine on the larger mammals, furry mammals present in the forest ecosystem. Based on the literature survey, the biodiversity has been defined very simply: the variety and variability of biological organism. Biological organism, we all are well known, these are living things. Okay. The convention on biodiversity and similarly defines biodiversity as the variability among living organisms from all sources. The difference when you say that the variability among the biological organism, here the second definition, he had one more thing, that is all source. That means the place where they are living in. And therefore, combining these two definitions, the biodiversity is defined the variety among organisms from all sources, including interlayer, terrestrial, marine and other aquatic ecosystems, and the ecological complex of which they are living in. So, the biodiversity can be divided into species diversity and diversity between the species, that means genetic diversity, and the different types of ecosystem, that is ecosystem diversity. This picture shows the overall, the variety and variability of different types of living organism. You have plants, you have insects, you have amphibian, reptiles, larger mammals, aquatic birds, terrestrial birds. This is what collectively we call as biodiversity. When you talk about the genetic diversity, here I have shown the three pictures. All the three pictures, it is a viper. We have a lot of snake species. Viper is one group of snake, and within that viper, we have shown the three different species of vipers. One is the pitch viper, second is the central one is the straw scale viper, and the resolute viper. So, the first is the variation in the species and variation within the species, and third is the ecosystem diversity. India is known for one of the mega biodiversity country in the world. So it is divided into based on the geographical location, the geography or the landscape, and the existing climatic conditions, and the pattern of vegetation, and the community of animals living, the entire India has been divided into 10 biogeographic regions. So each of these regions contains different types of ecosystem, such as forest, grassland, wetlands, riverine habitat, mountains, hillocks, and which have specific its own unique plant and animal species, which is the biodiversity. So there are two physical factors influence the biogeographic region, which is the land cap or geological characters of the area. Component combined to form the ecosystems, and each ecosystem has got its own flora and fauna, which is the biodiversity. So I told India has been categorized into 10 third one is the desert, four is the semi-arid region and Western Ghats and Central Deccan Peninsula and Adriatic Plain and east and western coast and the northeastern part of the India and other island, Andaman, Nicobar and the Lakshadweep islands. So the India has been given, identified 10 biogeographic region. Each region has got its own biodiversity attributes. Here I would like to present the biodiversity value of arid ecosystem. See, these are the different types of biogeographic zone, and it has got the different biodiversity habitat structures. You can see the snow peaks with meadows, and dry season the meadows are snow line usually used to have snow peaks and open meadows with perennial herbs and short grasses, and down to that you will have the Himalayan, which has got dominated by coniferous forest, and the mid of tree line you can see the broadleaf forest, dense broadleaf forest. Here you can see the tropical evergreen forest in the Western Ghats, and within the Western Ghats you can also form one kind of ecosystem. And the other ecosystem which we have is the grassland. In generally in India, grassland has not given ecological entity. People think grassland is a open wasteland. The other ecosystems, which includes coastal and marine ecosystem, and eastern and western mangrove ecosystem. One is in Sundarban. The western mangrove ecosystem is dominated in Kutch district, and also freshwater wetlands, which are natural as well as man-made wetlands. All this ecosystem. Then the dryland ecosystem, which is the open scrub forest and desert hyper arid area, and also tropical thorn forest. These three ecosystems fall under the dryland ecosystems. Okay, dryland ecosystem. What is dryland ecosystem? Dryland ecosystem where the water is very scarce and which limit the production of biomass production, whether it is a crop, forage, forest, wood or other provisioning services. The drylands can be divided into four major types based on the aridity index. Aridity index is nothing but it is calculated based on the dividing mean precipitation, mean rainfall, by the potential evapotranspiration. Based on that, aridity index has been calculated, and based on that, four major types of arid lands have been identified globally. Here, this table shows the four different types of aridity index and different types of dry land. And these aridity, based on the aridity index, the share of global is 41%, 41.3%. All the dry lands in global share 41% of the land area, and 35.5% of the total population, global populations, and the rangeland, it shares 65% of the grassland, open rangeland, and also 25% of the rainfed agriculture, cultivated area. Rest of the 10% shares other city, town and urban ecosystem.
Let us see the uniqueness of the dry land. Dry land covers 41% of the total land surface. And it also produces 44% of the crops and also support 2 billion people, which is half of the world, and also support the half of the world lifestyle. So it covers 41% of the land area, it produces 44% of the crops, and support 2 billion people, and also half the population of the world lifestyle. Dry lands are often region where the water scarcity, but however, it supports very rich biodiversity, including some of the most iconic species. We are well known that lion, and even in India, deer lion found in the semi-arid area, and in Africa, you can see that lion, giant animal, elephant. So they are also home to diverse human culture, including some of the world's largest cities. Generally, rural communities in dry lands are often poorer than the other place where the people are living. The land is more vulnerable to degradation of climate change and due to direct human pressure. So this picture shows the dry land distribution of global dry land. When you see the India, here the most of the dry lands here fall under the semi-arid region. And also 34.7% of the global population live in this area. You can say between 10 and 20, where the 10 to 20 million populations living in this arid and semi-arid region. Global dry land area, the extent of area fall under different regions, under different dry land systems. It shows in Asia, arid land covers nearly 700 million hectares of land, and semi-arid land again little more than 700 million hectares, and dry subhumid 225.51 million hectares. What is the extent of area? The percentage of the arid area shares 25%. And semi-arid 26%, and dry subhumid in Asia shares 8.16%. In total, in Asia, the dry land shares 60% of the total global dry land. So, one of the biogeographic regions, what I showed that 3A Indian desert, the desert and the arid region, summer is very extreme, and it receives 40 to 45 degrees centigrade temperature, and it also experiences very extreme winter. During winter, the temperature goes to 5 to 10 degree centigrade. Sandy desert and the dunes are extended in the arid region. Predominantly, the vegetation types covers thorn forest. You can see the thorn forest here, the Acacia Senegal thorn forest, and open scrubland, and also tall grasses, and you can see Euphorbia scrub forest here. Generally, the topography is flat to open rocky mountains and receives very low rainfall. Most of the rivers are highly seasonal, ephemeral rivers, and predominantly rain-fed agriculture. Within India, let us see the distribution of dry lands within India. You can see Rajasthan, the arid area. Rajasthan is dominated in arid area, and arid zone shares 61% of the total dry land in India. When you take the Gujarat, it shares 20% of the dry land in the country. So in arid zone covers nearly 320,000 square kilometers, which is 12% of the India's total geographical area. In that, Rajasthan shares 61% of the total dry land area of this country. Here, these two pictures show the dry lands of Gujarat and Kutch. Here you can see the yellow portion. This area of the Kutch, Gujarat state falls under arid and semi-arid region. The green portion, which is the southern part of the Gujarat and the Saurashtra region, fall under the semi-arid or dry sub-humid regions of the Gujarat state. Within Gujarat state, when you see the agroclimatic region, the map which is shown here, the entire Kutch region, it falls under the arid zone. Though the entire Kutch, here I marked in brown color, it shows the arid region of the Gujarat state. Now we are going to discuss about the biodiversity attributes of this arid Kutch district. The Kutch district is located in the northwestern part of Gujarat state. It is the second largest district of the country. Even you see that in India, Kutch is the second largest district in terms of extent of area, and it covers nearly 45,652 square kilometers of area, and it contributes about 22% of the total geographical area of the Gujarat state. The Kutch district is in northern side. It is shared the boundary with international boundary with Pakistan, and the north Great Run of Kutch, and western side it is the Kori Creek is the boundary of the western side. The Gulf of Kutch is boundary of the southern and southwestern region respectively. Here this is the Gulf of Kutch and this is the Kori Creek. Here in the northern part it shares the border with the Pakistan. So based on the climatic condition, the entire Kutch district is fall under the arid coastal climate condition. There are three distinct seasons is are experienced in this district. One is winter, summer, and monsoon. As I told earlier, in the minimum temperature in Kutch district varies between 5 to 10 degrees centigrade, while the maximum temperature varies between 39 to 45 degrees centigrade. Being an arid area, it receives annual average rainfall of 326 mm. That even only within 13 rainy days. And therefore, the wind speed also very moderate to high, and the average wind speed reported 11.3 kilometers per hour. Kutch districts also experience very high evapotranspiration rate, which is 2.25 meter per year. And therefore, the aridity, the index of aridity is above 40% and indicates significantly deficiency of soil moisture and fall under the arid to semi-arid condition. According to Rogers et al., again, within the Biosphere Zone 3 Indian Desert, the Kutch districts, entire Kutch district, fall under Biotic Province 3A Kutch Desert. Okay, now what are the major ecosystem diversity? What are the major landscapes present within this arid Kutch? One is the Great Run of Kutch. It covers around 17,500 square kilometer area. Then Little Run of Kutch, grassland, mangrove, coastal area which includes the creeks, thorn and scrub forest, which covers around 2,800 square meter and square kilometers, and inland wetlands. Kutch has been reported a total of 340 inland wetlands, which are more than 10 hectares in size. And also the central ridge of the Kutch district is undulating in nature, rocky area with scrub forest, and the remaining area it is interspersed with agro ecosystem which is a rainfed cultivated area. Here you can see the topmost gray portions are Greater Run and Little Run of Kutch. You can see the southern part is the Gulf of Kutch coastal area, and you can see the dark spot, it is the mangrove ecosystem. You can see the red plus mark, this is the distribution of tropical thorn forest interspread with the rainfed agriculture. You can see these two marks, which is distribution of large extent of grassland. One is the Vanni grassland and another is the Nalia grassland. Now let us see the first landscape, the largest landscape and the largest habitat or ecosystem, whatever you can call it as, that is the Great and Little Run of Kutch. The brown portion, which is the Kutch, Greater Run of Kutch, and the small portion is the Little Run of Kutch. The Run of Kutch is inundated by saline water due to the highest high tide line, and during summer the entire saline water get dried up and it gives the totally white salt crust in the entire Greater Run of Kutch. The Greater Run of Kutch is locally they call it as a saline desert or white desert. In some portion you can see the area with totally dry land. You can see the salt encrusted, and the fringes of this Greater Run is spread with open scrub forest area, predominantly dominated by grass, shrubs and woody shrubs, and also euphorbia, which is one of the cactus variety. This is the way the saline desert, the run looks like. Ecological importance of this run. The Greater Run of Kutch covers around 17,000 square kilometer area. The Little Run of Kutch covers 518 square kilometer area. The fringe areas provide thorny vegetation and grassland habitat. This periphery of this Little Run of Kutch and Greater Run of Kutch is the habitat for wild ass. This is the only habitat in Asia where you can see wild ass. This within this run area, a total of 4,953 square kilometer declared as a Kutch wild ass sanctuary. This vast stretch of open land helps this animal to gallop, to run, and to start the breeding behavior. That's why this run forms the unique habitat of the arid Kutch district. In addition to that, this run also provides habitat for flamingos. The run forms, as I told, during the high tide time, highest high tide, the coastal water enter into the run through the Kori Creek. The run form, that's why the run form seasonal wetland. The Little Run provide habitat for Greater flamingos, and it is the largest breeding habitat in Asia. Therefore, this entire Little Run, the part of the Little Run, is known as the Flamingo City. Nearly 1.5 to 2 lakhs of birds breed in this Little Run of Kutch during the suitable year. That means good rainfall and good high tide line comes, the entire area inundated, it gets attracted by the flamingos and they come and breed here. You can see the small mounds and lot of eggs on these. You can see these lakhs, nearly 2 lakhs of birds breed in this area. Generally, the birds come from South Africa and Europe. So, in that way, the two ecosystems, the Little Run and Greater Run, is unique and also support wild as well as greater and lesser flamingos. The second unique habitat type is in Kutch is grassland. The grassland in Kutch mainland forms 24% of the various land uses identified within the Kutch district. So around little lower than 25% of the Kutch is interspersed with grassland. This grassland, you can see the map, the distribution of patches of grassland here. These grasslands have been identified, 34 species of grass with 107 plant species, which also support 12 herbivora, 67 birds, and 18 species of mammals. In that way, Kutch grassland is grassland is support high floral as well as faunal diversity. Within the grassland, Bunni grassland is well-known grassland. It covers around 3,850 square kilometers. You can see the vast area of Bunni grassland. Again, this is the largest grassland in Asia. Previously, we have seen the only habitat for wild ass in Kutch, the largest breeding flamingo city in Kutch, and the largest, Asia's largest grassland is located in arid Kutch. It is a dual ecosystem. This is not only the grassland, it is the dual ecosystem. During the good rainfall here, the entire Bunni, the low-lying area of the Bunni is filled with water, and that acts as the wetland. Therefore, the Bunni is grassland as well as it, during winter, it acts as the wetland. The maximum of 273 bird species have been reported within the Bunni grassland. It includes 107 migratory species. So the grassland is also important wetland. Livestock rearing is the major livelihood option in this area. And the Bunni buffalo, very recently, 5 years back, it has been recognized as one of the important national breeds. So in that way, Bunni grassland is unique for unique land for the livestock rearing as well as wetland birds. The another grassland which is located in the westernmost part of the Kutch district is Nalia grassland. It covers around 175 to 200 square kilometer area. This is the major habitat for the globally threatened Great Indian Bustard, and also habitat for lesser florican. Both these grassland forms potential habitat for spiny tail lizard. You can see in the right corner down, which is the only herbivore lizard in India. This spiny tail lizard also, this grassland bird also present in dry land of Rajasthan. You can see a small tiny bird here in the center. This is white-blue bush shag, which has been reported very recently. That means in 10 years back, after more than 124 years, it has been resighted in Nalia grassland. So in that way, both Bunni is good wetland and Nalia grassland is habitat for globally threatened lesser florican, Great Indian Bustard, and also habitats for spiny tail lizard. Now, these are the some of the faunal species reported in the grassland. You can see a lot of raptors in this area. This horned owl is, the Bunni grassland is known for horned owl. This area of grassland also support jackal, this wildcat, and also chinkara, and Indian fox, and vultures. So in that way, the grassland also support other faunal species. The third major ecosystem of the arid Kutch is tropical thorn forest. Tropical thorn forest in Kutch habitat covers around 2,800 square kilometer area, and it is mainly dominated by Acacia sinigal forest. You can see here, and Acacia nilotica thorn, tawny trees, Rubia tenet, Ziziphus malaria, and Euphorbia, one of the cactus, and two species of Salvadora oleoides and Salvadora pesica. These are the dominant tree species and floral species reported in this plant forest. You can see Nilotica species, Senegal, open scrub, and with cactus. To protect this plant forest, the Kutch area, within Kutch area, nearly 444 square kilometer area has been declared as Narayan Sarovar Sanctuary, mainly to protect the thorn forest as well as the chinkara, the key species of this thorn forest. Initially, this Narayan Sarovar Sanctuary was covered around more than 700 square kilometers. Because of the mineral resource logged up underneath this thorn forest, the government of Gujarat tried to denotify the area and it tried to bring down the 700 square kilometer area into 100 square kilometer. Based on the Government of India recommendation, Gir Foundation and Gujarat Institute of Desert Ecology, where I was working for 16 years, we surveyed and we recommended the Government of India to denotified area can be bring back into 444 square kilometer area. That's why now the entire NSS sanctuary is covering around 400 square kilometers. These are the major fauna biodiversity. Let us see the biodiversity of the thorn forest. The Narayan Sarovar Chinkara Sanctuary has been identified 10 major floral community. It has been reported with 225 plant species, 29 spider, 34 butterflies, 18 species of herbatafauna, and nearly 200 bird species. Around 183 bird species found reported in this tropical thorn forest. This is the key species for chinkara, which we locally known as the Indian gazelle. In addition to that, it has got the larger herbivore of nilgai. It has wild pig, desert cat. There are two types of hedgehogs found in this thorn forest. One is the pale hedgehog, and the another is the long-eared hedgehog. Jackal, you have fox, and you have desert gerbil, Indian gerbil, and also field mouse. These are the some of the mammalian fauna reported in the thorn forest. These are the reptile species, unique reptile species reported in this thorn forest. You can say top left corner, this is one of the lizard, Cryptopodian cachensis. This is endemic to Kutch district only. It is not found in any other area. This is endemic to Kutch. Another thing, you can see the desert monitor lizard. You can see two species of snake, saw-scale viper and cricket snake. As I told earlier, spiny tail lizard, the only herbivore lizard in India, tortoise, panbo, and short-tailed agama, and lot of the freshwater turtle found in these man-made wetlands. The fourth unique habitat in arid Kutch district is wetland. Though it is the dry land, Kutch district support largest network of wetland in the Gujarat state. If the extent of area, wetland area covered in Kutch district is 27.17 lakh hectares. This is mainly because of the two seasonal wetlands, which I told, the runoff Kutch. The Kutch region wetland accounts 21.77 lakh and it formed 80% of the state. The greater and little runs and bunny grassland, as I told, inundated with the rainwater from the shallow wetlands and larger dimension of locally known as the dun. This is the locally known as dun, which is nothing but this low-lying area and natural wetlands. In addition to this run and bunny wetland, many medium and minor irrigation dams have been constructed by the state government, and around 132 such dams are acting as a man-made wetland in the district. Nearly 340 wetlands identified as a man-made wetland, which are more than 10 hectares in size. In addition to that, because of the large extent of wetland spread in this arid district, Kutch serves as a gateway for migratory waterfowl. The migratory species come from the Europe and other area, enter into the Pakistan, then enter into the Kutch, and then it spread into southern and southeast region of the country. So, wetland is concerned, Kutch is the migratory gateway for wetland birds. You can see this map, how it shows the distribution of 340, more than 340 wetlands marked during the wetland project study in Kutch during 2008. The larger body of the wetlands, it shows it is mostly the wetlands within the bunny grassland. So you can see the view of other wetlands. These wetlands, Charid and Kirjo and Vekario, are known three major wetlands, which these are the three major wetlands, which support more than 30 to 50 thousand of waterfowl, comes under 25 to 35 species. As per the survey conducted by Gujarat Institute of Desert Ecology, where I was part of that survey between 2006 and 2008, the Kutch wetland reported 180 wetland birds with more than 1 lakh birds. In that, 99 species with 55 birds reported just in 10 wetlands. Among the 118 species, 63 species were winter visitors and 43 species were residents. The list includes, the wetland bird list includes 16 threatened wetland birds as per the Indian Wildlife Protection Act and Wildlife Protection Act, as well as the IUCN criteria. 16 threatened bird species, wetland species reported in arid Kutch. In addition to that, these man-made wetlands, 10 irrigation dams reported mugger crocodile, which is one of the endangered species. These are some of the wetland birds reported in this region: egrets, white murrain, you can see the painter shark, spoonbill, purple murrain, grey heron. These are the some of the ducks which reported in wetlands of Kutch district. You can see the pintail duck, Brahmini duck, barred-headed goose, spot-billed duck, pelican, and whistling teal, etc. Fourth, and though I have discussed about the mainland habitat, I would like to mention here, Kutch is also support the second largest mangrove patch in the country, next to West Bengal. So it can't, this Kutch constitute 991 square kilometer of the national area of 4,827 square kilometer, which forms 20.5%. Therefore, 20% of the mangrove extent of this country is located in Kutch district. The largest district of Kutch district, it covers the coastal area, it covers 727 square kilometer, which forms 77%, followed by Jamnagar Marine National Park, cover 141 square kilometers of the mangrove area. So out of the 991, Kutch is covered 71% of the mangrove. Therefore, the western part of the mangrove is entirely different from the Jamnagar part, which is the marine national park. This habitat, mangrove habitat, also supports a diverse marine fauna, which includes 37 species of mollusks, 21 species of crustaceans, polychaetes, and with 42 birds reported only in the mangrove ecosystem. When you see the mangrove ecosystem, there are 9 species of mangroves in Kutch coast, and the western part of the mangrove, which is close to the Koori Creek, it's supported by only one single species stand, which is Avicennia marina. This is mainly due to the erratic rainfall and high temperature, and also over exploitation. The western part of Kutch is supported by only single species. I would like to also like to heard few information about the Kutch coast. Gujarat holds the longest coastline of 1000 square kilometer, which constituted 22% of the entire coastline of the country. However, It includes the coast and creek of Kutch coast. It's 456 kilometers long. And these Kutch coast also support nesting habitat for two species of turtle. One is the green turtle and olive redly turtle. So I have done monitor the sea turtle population for the continuously for 6 to 7 years along the entire Gujarat coast, and it has been reported nearly 3,000 to 4,000 turtle nest along the Gujarat coast. Among the coastal state, main state of the India, Gujarat is known for only green turtle is nesting in the mainland coast in Gujarat. Not where in other area, only other areas are mainly islands. So in that way, even though it is the arid area, this coastal ecosystem and mangrove ecosystem of Kutch district is unique in terms of supporting of the sea turtle populations and also other marine faunal ecosystem. So far we have seen the biodiversity attributes of run of Kutch, biodiversity attributes of grassland, biodiversity value of thorn forest, biodiversity value of freshwater, wetland, and mangrove and coastal area. Here, I would like to share the overall floral diversity. Kutch has got very long history of floral survey, starting with 1880 and till 2007. There are few floral survey, taxonomical survey has been carried out in this Kutch district. The number of species reported, it covers different areas and different extent of areas and different locations, starting with 200 species. The maximum number of species reported was Joshi by 2004, which is 964 floral species reported in Kutch. Let us go little detail. Out of the 964 species reported in Kutch, 735 species, which is around 76% of the species, are purely wild species. Only 24 species are cultivated or ornamental or planted. So it clearly shows, even though it is the arid area, it shows a very high biodiversity, floral diversity. However, when you see that, habit, the life form of the species, herbaceous form is highly dominant. As we discussed, due to the arid condition, low precipitation, very high temperature, there is no much tree species. The tree species has only 15% of the different life form, and herbaceous vegetation, it has 45%, and nearly 99% species of grass have been identified in this arid Kutch district, which has around 10% of the total flora. In addition to that, the 2004 survey, out of 964 species, around 402 species has been reported as the medicinal value. It itself will show the ecosystem services of this arid land. In that 402 species of the medicinal species, 57% herbs and 11% are shrubs in nature. Here I showed some of the threatened, rare and threatened flora of the arid Kutch. Around 23 plant species have been identified as rare and threatened at a different level, national and state level, not at the international level. It has been reported based on the rareness and also and threat they are facing. Because of these species are herbs and shrubs, there is no much importance has been given to these threatened species. And you can see some more species here, and the Indigofera, Ephedra, Foliata. There are two species of Ephedra reported in Kutch. In that, Ephedra foliata is one of the species of this dry land. During 1999-2001, the survey, we marked the distribution of all the 23 threatened species in this district and here marked based on the abundance and the availability and the density. We here mark two locations. One is the central cut and western cut, Abdasa, where the Nalia grassland is present. Identified two biodiversity hotspot based on the threatened floral diversity. Let us see the overall faunal diversity. Kutch has been reported 765 species of fauna, which includes nearly 240 invertebrates, fish and prawns and 150, amphibian 8, reptile 44 species, nearly 306 bird species. This is the overall faunal diversity and 51 mammalian fauna. When you compare the threatened species, faunal diversity of the state, Gujarat state, reptiles, out of 12 reptiles has been identified as a threatened species, 8 reptile species have been reported in Kutch. As I told, the spiny tail lizard and one endemic species, Cryptopodian kutchensis. Out of 10 globally threatened species of birds, 9 species reported in Kutch. Out of 16 mammals, 10 mammals, threatened mammals are reported in Kutch. Overall, if you see, out of 40 threatened species reported in Gujarat, 27 species. That means nearly 67% of the threatened species of the state is reported in Kutch, and therefore the arid or dry land of the Kutch is highly conservation important. This is some of the threatened faunal diversity of the arid Kutch. You can see wolf ear, as I told, you can see lesser flamingo, and globally threatened great Indian bustard. You can see the caracal, which prefer the grassland habitat, both the Nalia and Bunny grassland. You can see black cobra, very common here. Out of 2 species of spiny tail, hedgehog, you can see this is the long-eared hedgehog. It is the threatened species when compared to the pale hedgehog, which is common. You can see the desert monitor. You can see the pyritate and desert cat. Then we prepare the map, distribution of threatened faunal diversity in the arid Kutch. We reported again the Nalia grassland, the western Abdasa taluka is highly known for lot of many diverse threatened faunal species. In that way, a total of 30 biodiversity hotspots have been identified in this entire Kutch district. Now, we have seen different types of ecosystem and uniqueness of each ecosystem and overall biodiversity of floral and faunal biodiversity of Kutch, and the conservation issue identified in Kutch can be divided into two. One is the major cause, second is the supplementary cause. Here the problem issues I am discussing only specific to the Kutch district. Invasion of Prosopis julii flora, overgrazing by domestic livestock, habitat loss and discontinuity due to mining activity. Kutch is known for high mineral resource. Nearly more than 12 major minerals are located in Kutch. And wild ass habitat has been fragmented due to Narmada canal development. Uncontrolled exploitation of salt pan around wild ass and coastal tract. I told that runoff Kutch has been, they are trying to develop salt pan, converting the wildest habitat into salt pan. That is another major issue. Industrial development, as I told earlier, because of the open land, because of the presence of thorny scrub and thorny trees, people generally, the developers think it is the wasteland. Therefore, ill-planned developmental activities in the mainland as well as the coastal area threat to the arid biodiversity. The second supplementary causes, there are a lot of hunting pressure, hunting on desert hare, hunting on spiny tail lizard, killing of crocodiles in the man-made wetland, killing of wolf by the maldaris. Maldaris means there is livestock rarer, of this Kutch region, they smoke the den, wolf den, and smoke the pup. And that, therefore, they hunt them. It is threat to the wolf population in this area region. Over exploitation of medicinal plants and exploitation of native trees for charcoal making and fuel wood. Lot of cutting and lopping pressure and grazing pressure in mangrove habitat during dry, drought year. The local livestock rearers, they graze the camel into the mangrove ecosystem, and also they collect mangrove seeds as a fodder for the livestock. Human wildlife complex due to crop damage by wild animals, mainly nilgai. Okay, the importance of biodiversity, it is well known fact. Biogeographic region has got its own ecosystem biodiversity. The biodiversity provide a different ecosystem service, which are life supporting system. These are the common, everybody knows. Based on the high biodiversity, we do get high ecosystem services, provisioning service, food, crop, livestock. It is well known that arid areas known for livestock based livelihood and aquaculture and fisheries are the main. Wood and food, fiber, timber, cotton. There are a lot of goods and services we get. The other regulatory service, regulation of air quality, climate regulation due to the carbon sequestration at the regional and local level, regulating the water flow, control the soil erosion, disease mitigation and water purification and pollination, and other ecosystem, the cultural service, recreation, ecotourism, ritual, education and research. These are the ecosystem service we get from the different habitats. Nutrient cycle, primary production, photosynthesis, water cycle. And I would like to give only few importance of the selected ecosystem service of the dry land. In dry land, due to the long day and high solar energy, solar thermal electricity. This is because of the presence of solar energy in the area. Nowadays, the solar-based thermal electric production of solar-based thermal electricity is known in the globally, and it has been highly marketed in many countries like India, China, Kenya, Mexico, and South Africa. So the arid ecosystem provide ecosystem service in terms of giving solar energy. The second energy is wind energy. Wind farms need to be in open. Therefore, the open dry land is known for wind energy. So there are two types of ecosystem energy under the energy ecosystem service. The dry lands are known for solar energy as well as wind energy. Then high biodiversity. As I told the presentation, the Kutch itself is one good example. It support nearly 735 wild flora and 765 species of fauna species. Kutch is known for livestock based income. Then you say the tourism, Rajasthan and Gujarat, Kutch is known for ecotourism, specifically to see the dust, the desert area, and see the port. In Rajasthan, tourism is attract because of the desert and arid region. In Kutch, last 10 years, Kutch is known for run uchav. Now, nearly 1 or 2 lakhs of people gather in 10 days festival in Kutch, the great run of Kutch and little run of Kutch, visit this, and it fetches few crores of rupees to the state. How And third point, the carbon sequestration, climate change. An estimate shows out of the 2,500 gigaton carbon sequestered in 12 region, 740 GT of carbon stored in dry land, which shows 36% of the total carbon sequestration in the globe. So ecotourism, livestock based ecosystem services, energy based ecosystem services, and also support high biodiversity value, and also support carbon sequestration, which is the burning issue in our days. So the arid area absorb 30% of the atmospheric carbon and stored in the soil as well as the land material. This map shows how the solar and wind energy is distributed in India. You can see Rajasthan and Kutch and Gujarat. You can see the western part of the thing, and how the solar energy is distributed in India. You can see this arid region of Kutch and Rajasthan is known for good source of solar energy. The management strategy. What are the management strategy? Here I broadly discuss gap to be identified. Whatever the presentation which I did, it is the review of nearly more than 12 years of study carried out covering different aspects in different locations of the Kutch district. So still there are a lot of gaps. So gaps need to be identified in terms of assess the biodiversity information. That should be need-based information generation. Identify and understand area-specific problems. Prioritize and strengthening the biodiversity conservation and management programs. The management program should focus on involvement of stakeholders, diverse stakeholders, monitoring the process of biodiversity conservation and their sustainability. Once the management intervention taken place, it has to be monitored long term. So the challenge of climate change in dry land. There are five major issues. Restoring the dryland ecosystems improve the health and function, including nutrient cycle that enhance their ability to absorb, store the atmospheric carbon, particularly in soil. So when you restore the drylands, the carbon sequestration potential is increased. Maintain the soil health. The restoration should focus on tree species, perennial plants, not the annuals. And the third, the key climate change adaptation in dryland is to maintain the ecosystem resilience and to strengthen the existing social and economic adaptation. Plan ecologically sustainable development. As I told, dryland means wasteland. That's for all the development is focusing on this open dryland ecosystem. Therefore, ecologically sustainable development need to be planned. Finally, sustainable resource use to avoid over exploitation. Human and the mobility in coping strategy that allows human and livestock to use the vast natural resource and landscape without over exploiting. Sustainable resource use. Restoration, ecologically sustainable development, plantations, and avoiding over exploitation. These are the four key factors which is challenging the climate change in dry land. So the biodiversity conservation, it's not one department responsibility. Biodiversity conservation will happen only multi-stakeholder involvement from the top level. Policy or decision makers, local level municipalities and implementation body, the corporate sector, the developers, the scientific groups, research and development, and educators, and also local indigenous communities, local NGOs, media, and more importantly, the youth, the students, the younger generation, should involve in biodiversity conservation. So biodiversity conservation is multi-stakeholder task. It is not a individual or single or concerned department task. So we all, all the stakeholders should join together, should focus on biodiversity conservation. So as a local body, as a villager, as a rural area people, there are three things which are very important to attempt the biodiversity conservation. First, we should learn about the biodiversity. Second is, and try to act, make responsible consumption. There should not be over exploitation of the biodiversity value. And start biodiversity nature club at local level, celebrate the biodiversity supporting days, and also speak and ask questions. Make your view known to the government and the private sector, and try to create awareness education activities to the locals and also local NGOs, students and youth. First, try to learn about the biodiversity in and around your area, and try to protect the biodiversity and use the biodiversity sustainably, and start speaking about any issues identified on biodiversity conservation in our area. This is the three ways we can conserve the biodiversity with the involvement of multi-stakeholders. So let us conserve the biodiversity value of our own region, our local area, for the future generation. With this, I thank all the participants and also BCF to given me the unique opportunity to share my nearly more than 16 years research experience in the area region of Kutch district. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you for preparing a wonderful presentation for us.